Hi, I'm Rob, and today I'd like to present to you a new compound open mortise tenon and spline jig. And this one stands out because it has a lot of adjustment possibilities. And that's what none of them, of the other ones I've seen on the net, have. And that's what I'd like to show you. By the way, it is a prototype. I made it out of scrap. I changed it already many times. So it's not really the most nice looking, but it's very functional. And this one is specially made to fit on the vault fences. Now I clamped in two pieces of wood, and he's still on the old mark, so I can make the cut. Okay, now it's clamped in on the other side, and now we're gonna make the second, probably the final cut. Well, I chiseled the rest out, the middle part, and let's see for the size. Yeah, great, beautiful. I think that's great. Well, a pretty tight fit. I think, yeah, I'm glad with it. Well, if the fit is a little bit too tight, we also can introduce then a shim behind it. And this is in this case 1/10 of a mil. It's copy paper, or thinner. At the moment, for that size, I have only 1/10, but let's see. Okay, now I took off from both sides. I took off 1/10. Let's see. Nah, fits. That's a nice fit. Not too tight, not too loose. It's perfect. Look good. You can see that here is a little discrepancy. You see? Here. So this is not really in 90 degrees, this side. That's due to the angle, the difference of the angle. So I have to cut, in a way, the mortise. I have to cut it a little bit under maybe 7 degrees. So instead of making this one straight, because this is their 90, and then it becomes a little bit different. I think it's better to take this in the size, in the angle of this one. Well, you can see now the inclination. It's 7 degrees. And I cleaned this up. Maybe you can see that. So now it is quite equal. Yeah, you still have to sand it, but that's the thing. It goes about the principle. Well, if you want to make splines in frames, you can do it like this, out of hand. Well, if you don't feel so secure out of hand, what you also can do is a bit a la the match fit system. This is then the standard 14 degree dovetail. You know, it's a standard piece, a router bit. And I use then the clamps from the Vestool Traxxel. And that also fits. So you also can do it like this, and maybe someone in top. Well, if you get bigger boxes and you also don't want to do it out of hand and you want to make splines, then we can do it with a clamp system which goes all over. And two of them, and then you hook them up, just like that. Put them in the groove, the dovetail, on the other side, same thing. And yeah, well, you are in a way, you are in business. You see. So, and because of the sanding paper, you don't have to clamp it in that hard, you know, this one. So that is also a possibility. Then we have to turn the box to do the other corners. Well, splines under a certain angle is also possible. So this is then done with the compound. Yeah, you can also tilt your blade. It's just what you want. Well, if you are ready with the clamp, it's very easy to take away. There are slots in this part. So, move it out. Like this. Off. Well, this is the end of part one. And for the ones who are not interested in how to make it, I should say, thanks for watching, and maybe I see you the next time. And the ones who want to keep on watching, I should say, welcome to part two, and keep watching. Yeah, another thing, if you make a depth cut, take care with this wheel, because it has the tendency when the saw is on to do this, and then it comes in the most bottom position. So one way or the other, it doesn't go up on the thread. It goes down, and then it stays a bit in here. So, if you have to make a cut like this, well, lock it then with some sort of elastic band. You know, or to the other side, like this, you know, put it in here. But anyway, I have to make the cut now like this. So, for me that's at the moment no problem, but beware. Well, in order to place the resaw fans on your normal fans, you have to take off your secondary fans, or however you want to call it, it's a latch. And that latch is connected with two screws on your main fans. Problem is, if you want to take it off, you have to unscrew the little screws what keep it to the real fans.
And that is done in here with an eye. But in order to take it very quickly in 1-2 seconds on and off, what I did is I made from the eyelet, I made a hook. So I cut out here a piece of, I think it's 8 mil. I cut out a piece in here on this side, and then it becomes a hook, and you can hook it on and off whenever you please. And then I can fit very well the clamps for the resaw. So I took this one out, otherwise you have to unscrew it every time, and that takes a long time. And yeah, it's in plastic, so I wouldn't take those screws many times in and out. So I did it like this. I start out because the fans, the real fans, is only I think 8 centimeters or so. It's a bit over 3 inch, and then I connect it with these clamps, and I also have a video about it. So if you want to see how you make it, you can do that by that video. And that is then the resaw fans, and that's 24.8 by 8 3/4 inch. Ah, it doesn't matter much, you know, it's just what you have. And 63 by 22.5 centimeter, and that's where I start with. By the way, there is also a video about the resaw fans, so then you also see sizes and things. Well, this is then the back side, or the front side, I don't know how you want to call it. The end of the jig, and it consists the resaw out of 2 plates. One is a reinforcement, and that's for the attachment to the fans, and the resaw fans itself. And then we get some sort of a booklet, and that's the jig itself. With a hinge in the top here. Here it can hinge, and then we have in a way 3 plates. You have the base plate and the mortise plate, and this is double. And I did make this a double, that is 2 times 3/4, to give it some sort of rigidity. You know, that it doesn't flex, because yeah, if it flex, yeah, your size is off. Well, now we have to install the hinge, and the hinge, it's a crucial part, because if you mount it a bit out of angle, right away your whole jig is off. So that's where you have to take care for. So what I did is I placed the rolled part against the base plate, here, this one, put all the screws in, so that he is really parallel with your base plate, and then I place a shim in between, and that can be yeah, in my case that is 3.65, and I have then a piece of masonite and a piece of carton, and that gives me then exactly the 3.6. but if you don't have that, well, you also can do it with yeah, a piece of plywood or so, or whatever. This is then 1/4 inch. But the distance is not really a problem here. It is the equality of the distance. So it has to be over the whole jig, has to be the same distance between the plates. And if you put then a shim in between, like this, you see. I don't know if you can see that. Yeah, I place it then in between, like this. And then I put a small clamp on it. So then I put a bit loose a clamp on it. Yeah. So that it has everywhere, over the gap, the same distance. And then you can mount the second part of your hinge, and then it will be totally parallel with everything, and that's important. Well, to take these things off, yeah, it's quite easy. That's the thumb knob, the finger knob. Just take it off. Washer. And the cap nut. And then the outrigger or the adjustable bracket comes off. You see, like this. And then, yeah, you can open it. You see.
Well, here you see it in the back side. And that's where the whole stuff, yeah, hangs on, you know. And here you have then the resaw fans, you see. Now then I show you the inside. It's like a book. And, well, this is then the inside. Well, this is then the business side, let's say, of the jig. And the size is, the length is 17 and a quarter. And the height is 11 inch. Yeah, that can vary a little. You know, it's just what you want to use. Then this is 220 grit sanding paper. I glued it on top of it. And a number of holes. Like here. You see all these holes. Well, I'm gonna make these cuts on a router table, but you can do it also with a free router or with a rail, you know, it's just what you want. I do it now like this. Okay, we put the router bit. I put it 10.4 millimeter high. So that's gonna be the cut. And then 10 centimeters hard. From the edge, okay. Well, it fits perfect, so I think we can make the cut. And two dovetail slots. Then in here you see a recess area, and it's 5 mil. And you have to take that out of your jig to make space for the saw blade if you have to start in the beginning of your leg or your piece of wood what you want to cut, you know, the stock. So not to clamp off then the blade in the jig, I took 5 centimeter. That's usually the cuts what you make for that sort of things. Well, these are all the components which go with the jig. Yeah, it's quite a collection, but we go over it one by one. Well, then we begin with this one. This is a cross piece, and that's made with a depth gauge, and that's made for to check if your blade and your fans are really in line with the miter slot. This goes to 1/100 of a millimeter, and yeah, that you probably need in the first place, you know, when you set the table. Then we have a clamp, there is a video about. Another clamp system that goes all over for if you do two pieces together. And then you can span them in from one side of the jig to the other one. And also for boxes, you can also use it for boxes. If you have to bring splines in, and then you can clamp the box, but I show you later. Then the rest. Here we have the two tables, left and the right one, let's say. A sacrificial part. It comes behind the wood for the tear out. And here we have, yeah, de spacers voor ja, zijn preset mortise or compound angles. Then we go further. Here we have the dovetail slider blocks, a few. Here we have an extra long one, that pin. In my case, the pin is 17 centimeter. So, yeah, what will it be? Six inch. 7 inch. And here we have some other bolts. And those are 8 centimeter. And of course, a few knobs here. Metric 6 and metric 10. And a set of spacers. Then you don't have to screw it on so many times, but we just fill it up with spacers. Okay, now we get a part that I want to explain to you how to fabricate the trapezoidal sliders, the dovetail sliders, you know, how to do that. Well, the first thing what you have to do is to make your dovetail slots. Well, I made two cuts in a way in the fence. One on 10 centimeters from the bottom, because that's also for your blade. The blade is 77 mil, it's 3/4 inch. So I'm just a little bit, that's 8 centimeters or so, 77 mil. And I'm a bit over it, so it's 10 centimeters. And the other one, I made it from the bottom down on 24 centimeters. And it's a double cut, eh? Double the blade. I take a test piece and I put the dovetail in the router table. I do it then with a router table. And this is then a standard 14 degree dovetail bit. Well, I'm gonna make these cuts on a router table, but you can do it also with a free router or with a rail, you know, it's just what you want. I do it now like this. Okay, we put the router bit. I put it 10.4 millimeter high. So that's gonna be the cut. And then 10 centimeters hard, yeah, from the edge, okay? Well, it fits perfect, so I think we can make the cut. Well, I start with this sort of poles. It's hardwood. I think it's Eurasian or South American. I don't know what it is, Bankirai. But it has a very fine grain, but it's very heavy. It's way more heavy than oak. And you can buy that, I think, in garden centers. And they use it for fences. You know, but it's an extreme hardwood, but with a very, very fine grain. Yeah, it's difficult to see, you know. But it's a very fine grade, and it's also it's very, very strong. And then you create, I make them then 14 mil wide. So it's 9.2 by 14 or so. Then I start out with to cut those. Well, I use now the latch, because yeah, it's a bit fine work, and then you have more space. Well, the blade is set on 14.2 degrees, and now on top of the ledge, where the wood almost will be the height, the biggest width of that dovetail block, I put it on 14, and I have to end up something around 12 and a half or so.
So I have a bit spare, but that's where I start with.
Well, to keep it a bit straight, the board, I do it and with a push block, I can manage it like this. And I cut it 14 mil.
And now I'm gonna cut it in size.
Now, easily to creep up, yeah, it's very easy. I do that with shims. And in this case, it's a piece of edge bending that is
0.65 mil.
So now, if I put this in between of the ledge, I move up 0.65 mil. And so I creep in, or you do it with a piece of paper.
This is then 0.18 hundredths.
You know, and if you take two, it's 3600 and so on. And so you can eat off every time you measure, and you come a bit to closer and closer to the desired width. And that's how I do it. And this should be a bit the tightness of the fit where you should be after. You see? It's partly clamped, but it doesn't fall through. Look, this is a bit how it should look, you see, and it's still under the surface. Now then you have to scrape off the dovetail blocks. I did it for 45 mil each. Center of the holes is then also 45. Well, now the tapping and drilling. They advise for Metlic 6 in this case, drill number 5 millimeter, but I make it a little bit smaller. I have 4.8, and first I determine the middle, you know, with your fans, that you adjust your fans that it's exactly in the middle, and I do that then with a bread point, you see. So then I drill a 4 mil hole. This is then 3.97 mil, and then I go over to the 4.8 because I want a tight fit for the thread. They say 5, but I do have 4.8, so I take this one out, don't change the block, put this one in. You have to do it then hole by hole, hole per hole. And then I only use tap number 2. And then I span in the chuck tap number 2. And I do the first threads. I do it then in the machine. And the rest I do on in the vise, on the workbench. And so I make those holes. So then for sure you can guarantee that your thread is really perpendicular to the block, you see. And that's in a way all. And then so I do them all, and then I cut them loose. Okay, now the tap is in the chuck. You bring the chuck down like this. It's still, you didn't touch the wood, so it's still really in the center of the hole. And then with one hand you press the chuck a little bit down. By doing this every time, you get it inside the wood. And if it goes for a few threads, you can take it out, just release the chuck, you know, and then the tap stays in the wood. Take the wood out and do it on the vise. Well, to grind a bit of a chamfer on it, on the thread, I do it in the drill, in the chuck, and then I keep it under 45 degrees against the grinding stone, and you get a very nice chamfer. Well, if you do it all nice, yeah, you end up with this. And yeah, real straight. And then this one is 17 centimeter. This one is 55 mil. And I have some others, and they are 40 mil length. And then in the end, what you can do is a drip of CA glue here on the rod, you know, a little drip, maybe also on the top, just a little bit. That's it. Well, as you can see, over 17 centimeters, quite straight. Well, also, yeah, with the bigger parts, the only thing what I scribe, those are these two lines. And the rest, the cut will do. And of course, behind it, because it's 24 teeth, it gives quite some splinters. I have yeah, a little piece of sacrificial wood behind it. Well, if you can see, well, it's not a bad result. Of course, it's an ATB blade and I should have a flat tooth, but I don't. But you get the picture. Well, this is then the compound tenon cut. And yeah, I call it tandem cut because I do two parts in the same time. So I make two tenons in the same time. So if you make have four, well, you're busy for two times, you know, that saves quite some time. Well, straight up, a compound cut you also can do. Because, yeah, it has also a 90 degree prefixed setting. Well, now we get the guide pins, the locator pins. And those are prefixed, preset angles. So, if you come with your table, let's say, I call this then a table. I have a right one, that's this one, a left one. Depends how you want to, you can put it like this up, you can put it like this up. Like this, you know. So if you use it like this, it comes on the left side, let's say. And if you use it square, then he comes on the right side. But it doesn't matter, because they are very precise made, and they are both equal. So it doesn't matter if you switch them, it's the same size. Anyway, I drilled them in 90 degrees in this case, compared with your table. Yeah. So now, and they don't go in it, they go next to it. And I did that because if you give them a fixed position, like this, the only position is like this, you know, where you have the holes. And if you want to go in between, yeah, you have to press them, of course, towards you. And you have to pull them back a little. So then you work without pins. But I thought, yeah, well, that's maybe a bit unhandy. Because then, if it has a fixed position on the pins, like this, it can't move up and down. So it has then always the same height. And sometimes you really want to be near the blade.
So then if it can move vertically, yeah, that would be nice. Now we get back to the pins. I choose for the bigger pins, like these. Where are you? Oh, here. They are 3 centimeters. And you also can do it with this sort. The only problem is that they are very short. They are from cupboards. You know, to get planks in cupboards, you know, to mount them in cupboards. But they are 5 mil. But they are very short. And the shorter, well, the sooner they wear out, you know, if you bump into them. And yeah, the hole gets wider and wider on top. At a certain point, they are loose. So I don't want to go there. I need extra precision. So with me, they have to stay on the place where they are, like now. Well, my pins, they are 3 centimeters. Yeah. And here I have a few storage holes, and there you can keep your pins in, you know, then you don't lose them. Well, then an explanation about the holes and the pins, the locator or the guide pins. This is where I start. Then, this was wrong. Here one, for if you have higher pieces of wood, you know, that you have more blade exposed, you could use this one. And this one. So that's 90. Then we get 8.5 degrees. This is another set of 90. For if you have bigger parts, you have to be more towards the beginning of your jig. This was a little bit too far, but I explain that later. Here we have a 30, 22.5, sorry, and a 30. And here we have a 45. So they don't go in an arch, they are in line. And on the other side, same thing. Where is it? Yeah. Here we have the same thing. 90, 8 degrees, 22, 30, 45 degrees. You see? So I didn't want to make an Emmentaler cheese out of it with all those holes. So I did exactly the holes what I think I'm gonna need. And if I need more holes, well, the drill is patient, you know. It's not really a problem. Well, the setup is very easy. You place one in here, for instance. Doesn't matter where you place it. 90 degrees. Place it in here. Take this one, put it in front. You get the sliders. Put the sliders in. Yeah, I can also take these ones. Fixed. Well, so easy is it? Well, now we get these tables. I call them tables.
I made them out of Baltic birch, half an inch, and well, they are long, let's say around 40 centimeter. Yeah, and the width is 1 inch, and the height of these things is almost 2 inch, I think, 1¾ inch, something like that. And they are precise made, so one is exactly the same as the other. You know, there is no difference. And the slot, I have it in under the table, let's say. The side part on also half an inch, something around 12-13 mil, half an inch. And then the gap is, in my case, I think 8, yeah, it's 8 mil. So yeah, I have a bit of play because the bolts are 6 mil. You know, the bolts which go in, they are 6 millimeter. And then it's 40 by the total size under is 36. And it's made out of half an inch ply.